Welcome to the news for the week of 20 September 2020. Zero Logon, Wicked Panda, OSINT, Doom found to run on, well, Xbox, and Dark Overlord. All this and Jason Wood will talk about single sign-on on this edition of Security Weekly News.
This is Security Weekly, for security professionals by security professionals.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
It's the show that keeps you up to date on the latest security news twice a week. Your trusted source for accurate security information and expert analysis. It's time for Security Weekly News. Do you know where your organization's crown jewel data is, whose data it is, what it contains, and if it's flagged, tagged, and classified accurately? Defense in Depth requires discovery in depth. At Big ID, they help organizations uncover dark data, classify sensitive and regulated data, meet compliance requirements, and take action for data on-prem, in the cloud, and everywhere in between. Learn more about how Discovery In-Depth can change the way enterprise organizations find, classify, and protect sensitive data at securityweekly.com/BigID.
And now all the news it's fit to blog about, or something like that. I'm not sure what that is. We talked before about this, but the deadline of 21 September for federal agencies has passed on the zero logon issue. So the Department of Homeland Security issued an emergency directive on Friday. So this is something they don't do very often, but they issued an emergency directive on Friday ordering all federal agencies to patch against the zero logon issue that we talked about previously. Microsoft issued a patch for this in their August 11 Patch Tuesday operation. But apparently a lot of people have not put that patch in place. So if you don't remember, Zero Logon is CVE-2020-1472. I put a link to it in the wiki. But it's basically a NetLogon bug that allows attackers to take over a domain controller remotely from anything that's on the premises. So if you're in the local network, you can essentially push this out and take over the domain controller, which means you could change the domain controller and admin passwords and GPOs or whatever else. It basically revolves around initialization vectors of AES CFB8 encryption, and those are supposed to be randomly initialized, but in this particular bug, if you push a consistent string into it, well, you know, guess what? It gives you the ability to spoof the information, and therefore you can roll your own tokens and you can get into the domain controller. The emergency call on Friday implies that maybe the patches have not been applied by federal agencies. We need to catch up there and get that done. And they said that you are in violation if you're sitting there today and you have still not patched this. So, okay, just so as you know. And for everybody else who's not a federal agency, it's probably a good idea as well. I couldn't resist this story. Somebody sent me this story the other day, and I really liked it a lot. Maze Ransomware has now adopted similar tactics to Ragnar. And basically what they did was they created a new way to deliver ransomware that actually bypasses a lot of the security people advocate for anti-ransomware stuff, which means they run it in a VM. So basically what they did was they took a Windows 7 image, they put the ransomware on the Windows 7 image as an auto-execute script. So it's running inside the VM, right? So you have an admin privilege or whatever you want because it's your VM. So they put that in there. They make it an auto-execute script. They bundle the Windows 7 disk image with a really old copy of VirtualBox into a giant file that contains this little tiny piece of malware, and they bundle the whole thing up into an MSI executable. Now, it still means you got to click it. So somebody, or they have to inject it somehow. So they have to put it on a flash drive. So they have to get it into the building somehow. Once they do this, they can execute this. It builds out the VirtualBox image and then auto-executes the ransomware. So basically, the ransomware is not running on the local machine. It's running on the virtual machine on the local machine, right? So it starts to get a little confusing right about there. Well, so what does it do? Well, it unpacks, and you have the initial ransomware thinking it's infecting a regular Windows 7 machine, which it's designed to do, but now it has admin on that local machine inside the network. And if you think about how VirtualBox works, probably it's bridged into the network with the same IP as that local machine. The ransomware then does what it normally does, which is go out on the network looking for shares it can hijack and spread to. So this is a new way to get this ransomware into your network. And it also means that you need to start thinking about how your privileges and your GPOs and so forth affect things like virtual machines that are running. And I mean, that, you know, starts extending into the whole Docker space and all that kind of stuff as well. A flaw in Firefox for Android will allow users in the same Wi-Fi network that with the victim can launch new Firefox windows on other Android phones that they're in the same segment with. So Chris Moberly pushed out a blog on this on Saturday, which explains how the Simple Service Discovery Protocol engine can be tricked. So basically what happens is, like a lot of services like that I'm sure you're familiar with, SSDP just sends out all these broadcast messages all the time looking for others' devices with UDP. So it's sending out a UDP multicast and saying, hey, is anybody out there? Is it like, you know, Cisco Discovery Protocol or any of these other kind of things? So it's just beaconing. And then just like every service, as it advertises itself, you can find it. So basically what is expected is an XML file that contains UPnP information specs for that device should be handed over. But this blog entry, and I put both the blog entry and then another description of exactly how it worked. The blog entry describes a malicious SSDP server that you run on your own device that sends a message that, instead of pointing to what it thinks is the XML file, points it to a an intent URL. So the intents, which is what Android calls these things, redirect the user to another application so you can just launch a browser. So you can launch all kinds of stuff, but this particular one was, they're going to point you at senorfufu.com on somebody's phone and pop up a Rickroll or something like that. So it's really like this, you know, sort of a practical joke thing. It's a great blog entry, and it's a proof of concept that affects Firefox for Android before version 79. So it's worth reading it if you don't use Android, but if you use Android, it's even more interesting to read. Nathan Wyatt, a reputed member of the Dark Overlord group, was sentenced in U.S. court to 5 years in prison for his role in the scheme, which occurred in 2016. Dark Overlord hacked multiple companies in a variety of sectors and stole sensitive data from the companies. They specifically focused a lot on video game companies and on video game... That wasn't them. That wasn't... Dark Overlord was extracting information. Sorry, I got it confused with another story I was thinking about. I'll tell you about that one in a minute. But it was an early example. The reason I was interested in the story, it was an early example of this, we will release your data if you don't pay. So they actually weren't using ransomware. They just simply extracted data, and then this Mr. Wyatt actually would contact you via email or telephone and tell you to pay up, or they would release all this information out onto the web. He set up supposedly all the email and phone accounts, but didn't do any hacking. There were other members of Dark Overlord that are as yet unnamed, and he did send all the threats. He's from the UK, and he got arrested there. He was held there for 14 months during all these extradition hearings that ended in 2019, and he was actually extradited back to the United States. But today he is actually in jail. Apparently he pled to this, so that may mean that there are more indictments not far behind if he had to make a deal to give up other people's names, or who knows. I don't know what he pled to or what the deal was. A little OSINT for you in that same light. Apparently an Australian hacker named Alex Hope received a photocopy of Tony Abbott's, who is a former prime minister of Australia. It was a Instagram photo of a boarding pass, apparently, on a Qantas flight. And basically what he did was he used the information on the booking or on the boarding pass, got the booking reference number from there, which is printed on every boarding pass I've ever seen. And he was able to use that on Qantas's website to access the passport number, comment section, and the phone number field that the customer had put in. So he was able to get PII information from them. Apparently, the Qantas said they fixed the bug, but it definitely reiterates the whole idea that, you know, never assume that OSINT is not going on and that all these documents and things from the past, where we still print all this stuff, is not valuable information for someone. So, you know, keep your shredder handy if you still have paper boarding passes. And, of course, somebody may be videoing over your shoulder when you've got it on your phone. Since we're doing hacking, the U.S. Department of Justice did indict 7 Chinese nationals who had targeted more than 100 tech and online gaming companies over about 10 years. The group, which is called APT41, used phishing and supply chain style attacks to extract data. And in particular, they were interested in grabbing up, various things to sell. So they were extracting things from games like Magic Swords and things that they could sell later and earn money. The group is called Barium, Wicked Panda, or Wicked Spider. I think I'm going to stick with Wicked Panda because I kind of like that. You know, Wicked Spider sounds a little too macho, but Wicked Panda sounds kind of cool. This group used ransomware and crypto miners to finance their activities. So basically, they went into a lot of different companies in many different sectors and ransomware them. They went in and they used, they extracted data to sell, data to threaten to release, and so forth. But then they also went after gaming companies and their customers. They were trying to steal bitcoins. They were trying to do anything they could to get things out of there. I mean, apparently, Magic Swords and all this stuff, and I actually did know this, have like a fungible value in the world, because you can sell these on various resale sites so people can move them into their gaming accounts and whatever. The group used fake resumes. They used phishing attacks. They used all kinds of stuff to get their initial malware into the companies and gain access. They also then, this is the supply chain part of this, they embedded malware into the software of gaming companies, and the gaming company then distributed that the software to their users, so they would write add-ons and mods to games, and then the gaming company would push those out as, you know, new things. And so that was pretty exciting. At least one of the members, whose name was Tan Dai Ling, was involved in the Anvisoft antivirus scandal that was probably almost 10 years ago now. Tan Dai Ling was called Wicked Rose, or Withered Rose, depending on the translator, and appears to be involved in this scam as well. So they all have been indicted. An interesting report showed that nearly 70% of the IT and security professionals surveyed said they honed their cyber skills outside the workplace. And I guess I really didn't think about that as being that odd or that it was that bad of a thing. It made me think about it, though. I mean, most of all the successful people I know in the tech and security world, and I know I have met a lot of people in this field, have a couple of commonalities. And one of those is that they really like this stuff and seem to spend a lot of time on it that's not just, you know, at work. I mean, you think about what you do in your spare time. I mean, do you join the bowling league or do you write Python code for fun? I mean, I know what I do, and I don't know how to bowl, but I mean, you know, I use the tech pretty much all the time. And when I'm not, you know, even when I'm not getting paid, so at home, I'm often spending time fooling with new things or trying things that I read about to see if I can get them to work. So I was thinking, you know, how quick could I learn to install a video card in Gentoo? I mean, that was something I took on one time, and it was not quickly, but I did learn a lot by doing it. But anyway, this study was talking about how 46% of the organization don't confirm new hire skills, which I think is a huge mistake, and 40% of those companies never even evaluate people's skills, which I mean, sometimes it's hard to evaluate people's skills, but they just don't really keep up with it. I thought the story itself is kind of convoluted, but I think the point, and my point, is that maybe we need to stop assuming that all our tech's set at home and that maybe they're not learning the newest cutting-edge stuff because they're not. Maybe they joined the bowling league. And as the industry matures, you are going to have more people in this industry who are in bowling leagues and doing other things besides sitting around on their own time learning the newest and greatest things. So watch Security Weekly, if nothing else. But you know, I mean, seriously. A German ransomware attack is now being investigated by the German authorities as a possible manslaughter case. The attack, which was on the university clinic in Dusseldorf, shut the clinic down due to the ransomware infection, and a patient had to be redirected to another hospital due to the shutdown and subsequently died as a result of having to be transported a lot further away. Most of the experts, articles I read about this basically said, you know, the manslaughter aspect was probably going to be a reach because it's going to be difficult to prove in court that the person who ransomwared them, assuming they ever figure out who that is, it actually was intending to commit manslaughter or whatever. And I know there's all kinds of, and I'm not a lawyer and we won't get into that. But the real point of this article was that who is liable here? So this attack was based on a Citrix VPN vulnerability that was well known, had been around for a long time, and the clinic had just not got, or whomever their support was, had not gotten around to patching this, and that allowed them to get ransomware. So it seems like there's a lot of civil liability issues here around these kind of failed to patch known issues, like the DHS issuing this thing on Friday saying our agencies haven't put the August patches in place, and then they get ransomware or they get hacked or whatever. Maybe there's a lot of civil issues that are going to come up around this, saying, you know, you come on, you didn't patch this. So they were saying that a lot, that 20% of these events resulted from incidents that were over 7 years old. I mean, like 7 years, if you can believe that. But when we return, we will talk with Jason about single sign-ons. So stick around.
The question is simple. Have any of the systems on my network been compromised? The answer is harder than it should be. Enter AI Hunter. Active Countermeasures has automated and streamlined techniques used by the best pen testers and threat hunters in the industry to create AI Hunter, a network threat hunting solution that does the first pass of a hunt for you to identify systems that are most likely to be compromised and scores the results on a scale from 0 to 100. You can then research those systems in depth with AI Hunter. Focus your valuable time on the systems that need your expertise with AI Hunter. Sign up for a personal demo today at securityweekly.com/ACM.
Well, he's not just any desert hacker. He goes by the name the Sandman, the Jackal, or sometimes the Horned Toad. Jason Wood joins us to talk about thinking twice before using Facebook, Google, or Apple to sign in everywhere. Hi, Jason.
Hey, Doug. How are you?
I'm okay.
Yeah. So this article caught my eye. This article caught my eye on Wired about using what they call consumer single sign-on. And while there was nothing I think listeners would find wildly new in this, as I was reading through it and thinking about my own thoughts on what they were saying, it turned out to be a pretty good exercise in how I evaluated the risks of this type of single sign-on. And again, this is consumer single sign-on. It's not the stuff your company may pay for to implement. This is, you go to a site, sign in with Facebook or Google, and then you don't have to create an account. Nice and convenient, but there are some ramifications of this sort of thing. They start off by pointing out the very obvious issue that, hey, we have like hundreds of accounts that we create all over the place, and we're not supposed to reuse passwords. They're supposed to be long and complex and difficult to remember and yada, yada, yada. And of course, everybody reuses passwords, and we know what happens there. So companies like Google, Facebook, Apple, others have created single sign-on offerings that are free for the end user that companies can then leverage for authentication on their site. A little bit of a benefit to the company. They feel like, we don't have to, this makes it easier to get people to come in because they don't have to worry about trusting us with a password or whatnot. But Wired article asks and provides their answer as to whether all this is a good thing or not. Now, on the surface, to me, it obviously sounds like a good thing. I certainly trust Google's authentication platform far more than I trust most other sites that I run into out there. I have no idea what they're doing. We've covered so many stories on sites that have had security issues and crappy password storage and password reuse and whatnot. I've tested far too many sites and actually managed a few that just make me shudder when I think of them and how they handle this. So as the user, it seems like I would benefit from Google's better security and still get access to the site in question. There are some issues. First off, they point off is the single sign-on implementation. It may be a more high-profile target for somebody, a skilled attacker to go after, and therefore, when they find a security issue, now they have access into loads of different sites and lots of different users. So, the impact of any type of vulnerability here or anything being exploited is much larger. They go on and they cite a Facebook security incident around their platform that exposed a single sign-on access for something like 50 million different users. And while they do say, state that Facebook reset the access tokens as soon as they discovered it, their focus was on the negative impact, the spread that they had. Though I do like the quick remediation that occurred there with Facebook. But still, the impact is really large when something like this happens. So, you know, we have the limited impact of one single site being compromised versus a big target. They also cited the issues around legal disagreements that could occur and screw up your access to sites. Case in point, Epic Games and Apple. They had a disagreement over how Epic was processing in-app transactions and wanted to get their money that they felt that they were owed, and they severed Epic's access to the App Store and the Google Developer Program, and as it turns out, also the ability to sign on with Apple, their single sign-on functionality. Epic started scrambling, trying to figure out how to communicate this to users and prevent them from getting locked out. Fortunately, Apple backed off and allowed Epic to at least have that level of access, and they did say that they never intended to actually remove the ability for single sign-on, even though it sounds like they did for a bit. So, out of all of this, is consumer single sign-on a good thing or a bad thing? Well, the Wired articles have decided that this is bad and that people should use password managers instead. My response is a little bit mixed on this. My preference is still password managers. I use my password manager heavily. I've got to deal with this across devices and all this other stuff, so that makes the most sense. And, you know, it applies to every site, not just places that, you know, have this bit of functionality built in for consumer sign-on, single sign-on. But, you know, I recognize there is some appeal to using this sort of thing to other users. You know, one of the downsides to recommending password managers, as this article points out, is just human nature. We in technology are maybe a little bit of an unusual type of user case, and we think we're the typical user, but we're not. We're willing to jump through some more hoops and use additional applications to get access to things we want. We're more likely probably to use multi-factor authentication and whatnot. Whereas other users, you know, much less the case. They just want to get access to it. And so to them, hey, this is one less password I have to remember, and or in this case, we'll probably reuse. And so they go for the easy button and log in with Google or Apple or whatever. So for these folks who aren't going to use a multi-factor authentication and who are going to reuse passwords and not use a password manager, you know, the single consumer single sign-on may be a useful option to them. So, you know, I get where the article is coming from. At the same time, you know, is it a good thing or a bad thing? Well, my answer is it depends. It depends on who the user base is and what they're targeting. For my part, I don't use it. I don't know what you all do. I use a password manager, but for your typical consumer out there, you know, I think single sign-on may be a better option for them. At least avoids the issue of their constant password reuse to an extent, though that's still going to happen because obviously this stuff is not implemented on every site. So go ahead and take a read. And honestly, just kind of go through your own risk analysis of it. You know, think a little bit critically about it and see what you think. If nothing else, it was a little bit of an interesting exercise to go through.
Well, thank you, Jason. I'm with you on that. A single sign-on means a single point of failure, but it definitely is a lot easier if you're dealing with people that when you try to explain what a password manager is to them, they get completely confused and or keep losing their like master passwords to their password vault. And I have had that with a couple of family members. So, yep. Yeah, I'm a huge fan of my password vault myself, but I do see the advantage of it. But, guys, I don't trust you, so... I'd rather trust myself, which that way I'm to blame. I have to fix it. So I don't just have to sit back and take it. Thank you.
But again, we're not the typical user.
No, I know. And I mean, I'm acknowledging that. I think you have to look at the person and how well they're going to use these things. So it may get there. I'm not sure it's there yet. But anyway, thank you, Jason. Finally, Microsoft bought Bethesda Software for $7.5 $1 billion. Yeah, that's a billion with a B. I was like, wow. I looked at that twice to make sure that that's what it said. That means that Doom, Wolfenstein, Fallout, all those great games will now be on the Xbox. You know, I don't know. Other games like Elder Scrolls, Skyrim, et cetera, are all going to be on there. Wolfenstein 3D was a game that was the first 3D game I actually saw on a computer. And it gave me virtual seasickness, which was quite new to me because I had never gotten regular seasickness, but I sure got it from trying to look at that game. Very strange. But I did learn a lot about refresh rates in that. So I ended up turning that puking experience with Wolfenstein 3D into, I learned a lot more about monitors and refresh rates when I was writing graphic code. And I did a whole bunch of experiments with that. And let me tell you, testing monitors to see if they cause you to puke is just really not that fun. But it was interesting to code. And I only puked once. I thought I was going to puke two other times, but I managed to run outside and the cold air sort of hit me. And I didn't actually barf those two times. But that thing would take me out. It was unbelievable. But I guess Doom really will run on anything. So, you know, now it's going to be on Xbox. And that's the news for now in the time of plague. I'm Doug White. Thanks for joining us for this episode of Security Weekly News. I'll be back this week on Thursday at 12:30 with the Security Weekly News wrap-up. See you there.